This particular session is focusing on a very interesting dimension, which is really the dimension of building the capacity to innovate. Now, this recognizes that, thank you, Steve. It basically recognizes that whatever we do, whether it is in terms of technologies, or it is in terms of systems, in terms of policies, we really need to make sure that we build the capacity to innovate amongst the different actors that are involved in this. And if the door can be closed for us, it will be very helpful. So this morning we did hear that there has to be a focus on getting things to the farmer. And we don't want it to look as if some people are delivering and all the farmers are doing is to receive something. We really want to make sure that we're looking at things not just at farm level, but at landscape level. We want to be sure that we're looking at things within an integrated systems perspective. And we want to be sure that there is a capacity to innovate which is being built across the different actors. My name is Kosi Atakra, and I'm director for one of the CGIAR research programs on integrated systems for the humid tropics. And you would see that there are other colleagues here from various groups. This session is going to be moderated for us by Stephanie Strom, who is with the New York Times. And she will be very shortly introducing the panelists who are going to help us to tease through these whole issues. What does it mean when we talk about integrated systems? What are the real challenges in terms of building this capacity to innovate? And what does it mean when we say we need to have multi-sectoral dimensions in partnership? So we're looking at all the different actors along the whole continuum. And the panelists will be helping us to tease that through. But at the end of the day, what does it all mean? How does it add in terms of contributing towards the global development outcomes and the global challenges? And especially as we keep talking about the sustainable development goals, how does this all play in? So that's what we are going to be doing through the panel and also through all of you. So once again, let me just introduce Stephanie Strom, and I'll pass on the mantle to her to lead us through. And I believe the first thing she will do is introduce the panel for this session. Stephanie?
I think you all are going to be really pleased with the panel. It covers sort of all the bases, if you will. We have some really distinguished people with us. First, I'd like you to honor Ruth Nankabirwa, the State Minister for Fisheries in Uganda. Ms. Nankabirwa also has dealt with microfinance portfolio in the past, right? So she's really got a great perspective on how multi-stakeholder partnerships and collaborations work, I think. Ruth, so nice to have you. And then next, we've got Anne Waters-Beyer, who is an agricultural sociologist. It's the first time I had ever heard of such a thing, so it's been a real pleasure for me. Anne has worked for more than 25 years in that capacity at the ETC, a Netherlands-based NGO, and has decades of experience working with partnerships of the type we're going to be talking about today. Anne, thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie.
And then next up, I'll get Sara seated. Sara Scherr, who is president of EcoAgriculture Partners. She's worked for many years promoting sustainable agriculture programs that involve multiple partners across the board, from the small farmer all the way up to the government minister. So, Sara.
Thank you.
And next we have Stephen Muchiri, who is the chief executive of the East Africa Farmers Federation, and thus is perfectly placed to offer the farmer's perspective, which often gets lost in this discussion. Stephen?
Okay.
Last but not least, we have Blake Ratner, who is currently working at the World Fish Center and is part of our CGIAR team here. So, thank you, Clay.
Thanks very much.
So, I'm going to draw a seat up here so I don't have to stand. And I'm going to ask Sara to start out by telling us what an integrated partnership looks like and that spans the gamut.
I think the dominant model today, and certainly until very recently, for managing land and water resources has been basically based on competition. Using land and water for food, using it for biodiversity, for forestry, for human settlements, for numerous other purposes. And conflicts between these were managed by allocating land to its supposed best use, political claims and struggles over rights, and through regulations. But in a world of 9 billion people, with the kind of growth in food demand we're expecting, the economic growth, the widespread degradation of ecosystems, and now climate change, it's not going to be possible to meet the full range of products and services that we need from lands and waters by having these sectorally independent actions, programs of work, and institutions. So it's not enough to save nature just by doing a good job in agriculture somewhere else, although that's obviously a very important thing to do. In much of the world, agricultural lands themselves are the most important watersheds and the most important habitat for biodiversity. In many places, our ecosystems need to be managed to protect and serve agriculture, on and on. That's really the only viable solution to addressing these multiple functions is to think about developing new institutions that engage all of those key stakeholders in the landscape, in dialogue, in negotiations, in managing trade-offs, in finding synergies, in developing collaborative planning to find innovative solutions. And indeed, where land use challenges are too complex or can't spatially be managed at the farm scale, but require too much specificity to be managed at a more of a national or subnational governmental level, then we need to be thinking about this landscape scale, which we use the term that we use for that is that it's a mosaic of land uses that have been influenced by a common ecology, economy, history, culture. And they can be of various sizes and tend not to have very fixed limits, because it depends on what you're trying to manage for. So what then is integrated landscape management? Well, that's really where you have long-term collaboration between the different stakeholders in order to achieve the full range of objectives that you're looking for from the landscape. You need stakeholder platforms, places where people can be formal, they can be informal, but you need a place where they can sit down and talk and argue, evaluate together, and work together. They need to promote land use practices that serve multiple functions. It's not enough to have crops that just produce food in many of these places. They have to also produce watershed services, the way that you grow them. They need a place to negotiate trade-offs and synergies between land users in different parts of the landscape, upstream, downstream water uses, or developing biological corridors, et cetera. So what we're finding is an enormous amount of innovation going on around the world because this is actually a felt need at the community level, at the landscape level, at a district level, at a regional level. And in fact, in Africa, we've documented more than 87 large integrated landscape initiatives that are already operating now. Well, we've identified more than 104 in Latin America, and there's a big study being done right now of landscape initiatives in Asia. They go by lots of different names: participatory watershed management, biological corridors, land care, landscape restoration. We've actually counted more than 85 of the different communities of practice that do this that have been very fragmented in their effort. But if you look at them as a whole, this is really something that's not a theory. It's something that's actually happening. I can give an example. I don't know if we have Let me just give you one example to sort of make it a little bit more real. EcoAgriculture Partners has been working for about 10 years with an organization called Kenvo that's operating in Lari, Kenya, which is in the central highlands. And it's an area of very dense smallholder settlement that happens to be located exactly in one of the very last remaining natural forests in all of Kenya. Mm-hmm. It's also one of the water towers of Nairobi. So the farmers are trying to make a living, trying to increase agricultural production, but in this context of extremely important ecosystem services and biodiversity. So when they started to work, they were an environmental organization, and they really tried to help local communities manage forests, protect water sources. And they were making progress, but things weren't happening at scale. And then they all of a sudden kind of realized that actually they were all farmers, and what they really wanted was help with farming. And so they started a whole new set of programs. They drew in agricultural NGOs. They drew in the local banks, agricultural banks. They brought in local businesses. And they started to generate a series of activities that they helped provide and facilitate to those farmers and communities that were helping with the forest conservation, forest restoration, watershed protection activities, and got them very motivated to do both. Contributed to livelihoods, had great success in forest conservation and forest restoration. They started ecotourism operations. They've got a landscape labeling program going on. And because they brought in different actors who had something to share, coming up with many ideas that the original organization would never have thought of. And this group continues to convene regularly to try to come up with new ideas that they can test. And they've been very influential at community-driven landscape initiatives, which is only one kind of landscape initiative, all over Kenya.
And so this was very grassroots?
This was a version of landscape initiatives that's very grassroots. Yeah. There's others that are very top-down led by the governments. Right. There's others that are even a few that are private sector led. And there's a lot of them that are NGO led. But they all go in with their entry point of maybe the thing that was most interesting to the convening organization. Mm-hmm. But what they've found is to be successful, they need to address the full range of needs that different stakeholders have. And the only way they can do that is actually to do serious work in the other sectors, but to do it in a way that they are mutually supportive or they're minimizing their trade-offs. Hmm.
So, Anne, how unusual is it to see that kind of grassroots, if you will, we have one thing, but we're going to turn it into something else, and it's going to work much better that way? How often do you see that happen?
Well, I think most people don't even recognize that it is happening. I think most of the development that is going on in smallholder farming worldwide is probably coming from such local initiatives. And it's when researchers and other development workers come in and recognize what the farmers and the communities themselves are trying to achieve, what they're experimenting with, what they're trying to improve, the questions that they have. If you can get more actors, such as what you're describing, to come together and support what the farmers themselves are trying to achieve, I think that is unusual. Mm-hmm. That the innovations, that the initiatives are happening is not unusual.
Not unusual. Well, is that because somehow banks or governments don't know how to reach the farmers? There's not a connecting platform? Maybe this is what Sara was talking about when she was talking about new institutions and platforms, that they don't actually know how to reach down or reach over to the farmer and say, what you're doing is really interesting, can you tell me more about it?
I think it comes from the whole paradigm of the way that science is done and the way scientists think of themselves and their role is, and we heard it this morning as well, of bringing it to the farmer. I think in the overall program here, if I recall rightly, it says at the top, delivering solutions, mm-hmm. delivering innovations. And that's the perspective that so many scientists
have. It's
like
upside down. Mm-hmm.
Rather than looking what are the farmers, the communities themselves working on, and how can we support that? And they might be a addressing the trying to address the same kind of problems, but with the resources that are available at the local level, especially when you're thinking of small-scale farmers, poor farmers, the women, the marginalized, they're working with the resources that are there, whereas scientists tend to think, okay, let's try to get the highest possible production, and then we need this and this and this and this, and we have to see that it is provided so that the farmers can do it. But the farmers are working in another way. They're looking, look, this is what is available. How can we use this best for the different purposes that are important to us?
Stephen, what do you think about that?
Yes, thank you. I think it's a known fact that farmers are the custodians of natural resources, and they have managed these landscapes for many years. They've been feeding all of us. Up to now, they're still feeding us. And a lot of the innovations that they've actually used to be able to manage whatever they are doing sustainably has been through a lot of indigenous knowledge that has actually been passed over generations. I think the challenge has always been to try and understand how they've actually done it and trying to document how they've actually done it with a view of trying to scale up or scale out or, share whatever it is they're actually doing. And I think that's what maybe creates a challenge between how then they engage with other actors, researchers, and so on. And like has actually been very well said, I think it's a mindset kind of thing. When farmers are viewed as beneficiaries of processes, as recipients of processes, that influences how then the design of the engagements, of the partnerships is going to be structured. And that then makes the whole thing go wrong in terms of how long is sustainably then, or that activity is done in a sustainable kind of manner. Now, there's a lot of information within farm organizations. There's a lot of expertise within farm organizations. And I think what the fraternity I actually represent would like to see is where they're actually viewed as partners. Mm-hmm. We are partners in an investment. We are partners in this endeavor. Let's exchange. Let's meet each other halfway. Let's see how we'll mutually benefit from the partnership.
So, Stephen, how often does like a research organization, for example, come to the Federation and ask for information about maybe dealing with drought or dealing with too much rain, on the other hand? How often do you see them come to you to ask for information?
That's a difficult question to respond to.
You don't have to be polite.
I think, let me put it this way. As a professional farm organizations, what we've done is that we've realized that we need to partner with all the actors along what you call value chains. Yeah. So we have partnerships we formed with government, partnerships we formed with researchers, partnerships we have formed with private sector, and NGOs that who we feel are important to actually what we're actually doing. We feel that over the years, all these actors are probably getting it wrong in terms of how they engage with the farming community. And we are trying to maybe correct that and try to position ourselves for them to actually understand whatever it is that we're actually doing. So what we have, for example, we have a strategic plan, which we always communicate to all these partners. We have MOUs with government, meaning that when they're rolling out programs on agriculture, I think you've heard about the CADIP policy program, that we're actually in it and actually making decisions around the priorities and things like that. When it comes to research, it's the same thing. We've tried to position ourselves, for example, at the regional level with regional research institutions in Africa. Mm-hmm. And the whole idea is to understand what the researchers are actually doing and to be able to try and communicate what the farmers actually want. So what the farmers' associations have tried to do is to create an interface, by bringing in professionals to help them run their institutions, but also to bridge the gap in terms of, communicating with other actors, so that they're able then to articulate best what the farmers want in a research kind of an environment, in a government kind of environment, and so on. So it's been a little bit more of trying to see how other actors are able to respond to the demands that are created by the associations or farmer associations, by having that interface that we actually, you know, creating. So we invite all these actors to our meetings, we invite them to our general assemblies, and they're able to listen, you know, firsthand mm-hmm. from the farmers. Mm-hmm. But now later on, in more formal arrangements, then we're able to communicate those issues in their boards or committees and so on. So the number of times researchers come to us, I don't know, maybe it's when they have a project they actually want to implement, and they're looking for a partner or a farmer group to actually work with. I think that's a bit more the way it's been, as compared to coming to understand what are your issues, and then how do we tailor programs or responses to your issues. Yeah, but I think this is a bit changing based on the arrangements that we've actually put in place as farm organizations.
So Ruth, could you maybe talk about the role that policy can play in all of this? Can it serve as a connector? Can it set the rules? What role does government have in this?
Thank you very much. Definitely, if you talk about sustainable development, you have to be aware that it cannot come without ownership of whatever systems that you are coming up with. The beneficiaries must feel they are part and parcel of that system, be it policy. If you as government is coming up with a policy, you must initiate that policy right from the grassroots. That is the only way you can be sure of sustainability. Mm-hmm. I can give an example. I'm in charge of fisheries resources, and our stocks are dwindling in Lake Victoria, Lake Albert. We have 6 big lakes. Mm-hmm. So the issue of surveillance and control are issues of both government and the fishing communities.
Yes.
Government has regulations which you are supposed to enforce on the size of nets you are using, on the methods you are using, but the communities themselves have to feel that the resource is theirs. So we established the beach management units basing on the principle of co-management. So the legal infrastructure mm-hmm. is very important.
Okay.
But it's not enough to enact a legal framework without involving the beneficiaries, the mm-hmm. communities. Okay. We have come up with the systems which can make government and the beneficiaries achieve the sustainability we need. And we call it the prosperity for all policy. And we identified 4 pillars. And the first pillar is on production and productivity. So under production and productivity, we had to ask the communities. There were 5 questions, but we are targeting on the selection of enterprises, what commodities, and in which region. So we zoned the country, and the farmers themselves agreed that, yes, in our community, we grow maize, we grow coffee, we grow this, and we zoned. After zoning, then we assure that we shall have group production. After group production, then the issue will be marketing and value addition. You have farmers producing as a group in a cluster, in a zone, in the country. You have to bring systems that can help in post-harvest handling, because Uganda loses 40% through, this is a very high percentage, 40%. There are no post-harvest handling systems like silos, like the ones I saw in Nebraska State recently. Okay? So we the farmers will grapple and produce, but produce for nothing. So the second pillar, which government thought, is to make a policy on working with private sector to make sure that once the production is done, the issues of post-harvest handling are done, and then value addition. And after value addition, then group marketing is possible. But the issue of information to the farmers was also very important. So we thought of the third pillar of community information systems. The Minister of Nigeria has talked about the e-wallet. Mm-hmm. Uganda is going beyond that. We want extension service delivery on a phone where you can just get to know the weather in that area, the extension service focal person for that area using your set. Okay? So there you will be sure that the system of communication, the system of getting information is guaranteed, because Uganda is widely covered by the telecom networks. Mm-hmm. Almost every village and almost every homestead has got at least a telephone or more than one line. But I'll also talk about the fourth pillar under prosperity for all, because it has to be a complete production chain, right from production, handling, value addition, marketing. It has to be complete. However, these small communities are comprised of people who do not have sureties in case they want to get loans, yes, from the banks. You know, somebody does not have a land title, he does not have a logbook for a car, he doesn't own a car, but he needs some money maybe to buy fertilizers, because we don't believe in Uganda, we don't believe in handouts, giving out seeds, giving out fertilizers, giving out, no, you have to really put in. So, and in my former portfolio as a minister in charge of microfinance, I was in charge of mobilizing the communities to form their savings and credit cooperative societies, their own. Government can train them. Government can give them the sets, the safe and the other machinery. But the seed money has to come from your meager resource. You must save. Saving is compulsory. Mm-hmm. And after that, you learn how to borrow from your own savings. Then government can come in later on to top up. So the fourth pillar is rural finance setups. And these finances must be accessible and affordable. So if you are a member of a savings and credit cooperative society in your village, your surety are the members who know you. Even if you want to borrow money to pay school fees, they know that you have a child who is going to school. The bank is far away from these communities, but the savings and credit cooperatives are within the communities. So whatever governments come up with must be for the people and for itself. Like the Nigerian slogan for farmers is that no farmer, no nation. And no nation, no farmer. This is, yes, the slogan I learned from Nigeria. No nation, no farmer. No farmer, no nation. So that kind of ownership is very important. You should not make policies and throw them to the people.
And so, for all of you, whoever wants to answer this, how common is something like that? How often are you going to find something that's been so well thought out, mm-hmm, from, you know, creating a system for aftermarketing, creating a system for financing, and so on and so forth, like the one that Ruth was describing?
I think if I could, yeah, pitch in, Stephanie, I think that the policy sort of environment, mm-hmm, that Ruth describes, at the level of the goals, it's actually becoming more common, mm-hmm, that we have clarity in goals from national government. And what the challenge is that we face in a world with 2 billion people who depend on smallholder agriculture is to learn more effectively how to respond to those goals, mm-hmm, and, as Stephen was mentioning, how to respond to the demands of smallholder producers themselves. Mm-hmm. As a research, mm-hmm, network, the CGIAR is the largest global network focused on research for agricultural development. Our obligation is to learn how to work within that space, mm-hmm, you know, in between the national policy goals on the one hand and the demands of those who are most in need, women and men and children, mm-hmm, who depend on agriculture and natural resources for their food and livelihoods. So I think, in a sense, what we're coming at from different directions is the need to bring together these different groups and understand that capacity to innovate is more than about technology. You know, as Kanayo Ndwaze was saying this morning, the president of IFAD, science alone without a social dimension can never be science for development.
Right.
And part of that social dimension is understanding that innovation is about technology, but it's also about innovation in institutions. It's about innovations in policies. And so our obligation is to try to understand better how to achieve the kinds of platforms that bring different groups together to deliver that sort of innovation, and to make more and more rare the situation that you described, Stephen, that, oh, the researchers show up because there's a project to implement. Right. Our obligation is to make sure that we're helping to create the conversations and joining in at the right time so that research is actually responding to those sorts of demands.
Well, you want to say something?
Yeah, I wanted to say something. you know, from the experience the exposure that we've had with all the engagements we've had with different actors, we've realized that you know, it's important that we take our space as far as you know, all these engagements are concerned, because many times we've had other actors making decisions on behalf of farmers.
Yes.
We've had government, we've had researchers, we've had prescribing what they feel are solutions to farmers. And I wanted to quote something that the Malawians also say. They say nothing about us without us. That's what farmers actually Malawi say. And what you're doing as the Eastern Africa Farmers Federation is that we're in 10 countries, and we have 22 national associations, which represent more than 20 million smallholder and medium-holder farmers. And we are striving towards you know, positioning farmers as credible investors. You know, we want a situation where when government go for these huge meetings and they're going with their private sector people, then they have a farmer representative in that particular you know, team. So we have tried to professionalize our organizations. We have tried to ensure that there's credible management in the institutions. And one of the things we're actually promoting, which I believe will be important for partnerships going forward, and like was said by Dr. Kin, they need to look at farming as an enterprise. Yeah, you know, we are promoting cooperatives. You know, it's something we've actually said going forward. We're going to use that as one of the things we're going to promote. You know, last year was International Year of Cooperatives, and this year, those of you know the architecture of East Africa. We have a regional parliament in East Africa Community, and we are currently promoting what we call an East Africa Community Cooperative Societies Bill 2014. It's actually on the second reading. And the idea is to see how cooperatives are going to form joint ventures across borders, across countries, to try and sort out some of the issues she has talked about, managing post-harvest, managing water resources, sharing information, value addition, and the most important, you know, generation of data, because one of the biggest challenges we have in our region, or in Africa per se, is that we don't have reliable data to actually inform investment. We don't have reliable data that we can actually use, you know, to develop any kind of interventions, be it on managing of resources and so on. And for me, just like Kanayo said, you know, there has to be a social side to everything. And you see, cooperatives have that kind of picture.
Right.
You know, it's social, it's economic, it's all that. So we are promoting that. We're hopeful that it's going to go through. And once it's law by the end of this year, then, you know, the sky is the limit in terms of what we actually want to do with that law. I think it's something we've actually said we need to take our space. People need to listen to farmers. That's why we've been in all these positions and all these spaces. And it's incumbent upon us to actually be viewed as credible partners. So we feel for any partnership to actually work, then there has to be, you know, benefit on both sides of the partnership. So we want to be viewed as partners, not as beneficiaries and so on. Yeah.
Well, so why? What are the obstacles to giving farmers, you know, instead of thinking of them as beneficiaries, thinking of them as partners who have responsibilities of their own inside of the integrated partnership? What are the challenges to getting financing? You know, how big of a challenge does financing present? Because so often the money wags the dog, right? That's just the reality of it. And so how does the donor or the investor then, does the donor investor have more of an influence, less of an influence, Anne?
Well, when you mention financing, I'd like to mention a study that we did quite recently for aquatic agricultural systems and climate change agriculture and food security, where we were looking at processes that went over a long period of time of what we call farmer-led agricultural research and development. Mm-hmm. And it turned out that these processes were not something that happened in 2 or 3 years, or even in 5 years, which might be sort of the standard length of a project. These were processes that went over 2 or 3 or even 4 decades. Mm-hmm. And what was really interesting is the ones where the farmers and the communities developed their capacity to innovate, developed their capacity to experiment more, take risks, try out different things, analyze what works better, what works not so well, to link up with other partners, to link up with different sources of information, and to interact in these partnerships in ways that they were in the lead. Yeah. Those kind of processes were funded over a long period of time with relatively low levels of funding. It wasn't sort of a big chunk of money that you've got to get rid of in 2 years, as the German government now does with their innovation centers, and they're really forcing to get rid of that money. That's not the kind of thing that builds
capacity. So where did the money come from, that kind of
the money? The money for those came from IDRC, was part of it. It was part of it coming from Miserior, which is a German church-based funding organization. They were funders that were committed to the vision and realized it would take a long time to achieve that. But kept supporting on a relatively low level over a long period of time.
So then the question is there that kind of money available today, right? Because most money I'm familiar with has a 5-year horizon, right?
I could respond, I think, to that. We've been, EcoAgriculture Partners serves as the secretariat for a global initiative called Landscapes for People, Food, and Nature, which started in 2011. And it was set up, it now has more than 60 partners around the world from different sectors who are all trying to come together to figure out how do we improve the quality and scale up these integrated landscape level projects. And I think they've really identified two big challenges for making these work. The first one is, how do you strengthen the capacity of these stakeholder forums? And they basically face exactly what Anne is describing. This is really about, it is really complicated to promote partnership activities between people who have completely different priorities, different language, different training, different power relationships, different kinds of technical expertise. This takes time to build the kind of communications you need. You often need like professional facilitation, or you need people with particular skills to build those and to support those efforts. Mm-hmm. And we refer to this as the sort of enabling investments that are required to catalyze the asset investments, to use the language of finance people. So this question about longer term support, because these are not projects; these are generational efforts to transform the social and economic and ecological processes within landscapes. So the companion part to building the capacities of those institutions to do their own work and to do their own planning and their own investment planning, for example, is that the enabling environment of the institutions that provide policies, finance, business, research, which have historically been developed in very narrowly sectorally. I mean, finance is a sub products in banks and things like that, need to be shifted. And the Landscapes for People, Food, and Nature initiative just last year did a major study to look at who is financing these initiatives and how are these initiatives financed. And the good news was there was way more financing than we had anticipated seeing.
And where is it coming
from? All sorts of different places that groups were innovating around this. And we saw it everything from multilateral institutions like the Global Environment Facility, which has been quite instrumental because they have been willing to support the stakeholder platforms, as well as provide, and then kind of leveraging large amounts of funds, to private sector investment funds that are actually trying to have multiple objectives as the result of the sort of a category of impact investments.
Yeah.
You're also having a lot of government programs. I mean, it's actually, there are some pretty interesting programs in places like Ethiopia, Burkina Faso, South Africa, and Central America. Gentleman today was talking about Peru and Ecuador, where there actually is quite a lot of public financing that is going to support these integrated initiatives. It still is dominated by the traditional forms of financing, but we're starting to see a shift. But it's still not. It's a very small minority, and I think there is really a need for both to, there's a lot of success, but we need much more systematic assessment of what is working and what's not. I mean, we're enthusiastic about everything. anybody who's doing anything is great, we really need to move back from that and say what's actually working and how would it need to be modified to really make it much more impactful, to make it so these landscape groups don't have to sort of say, okay, we want to do riparian restoration and we want to do agroecological methods and we want to do improved marketing, and that they then have to develop 6 different proposals to private finances and public finance to get what should be an integrated strategy. Mm-hmm. Very high transactions costs in the current system.
So is it then that perhaps there's more integration going on among the parties involved, the farmers, the land supervisors, the researchers, the NGOs, the governments, and that the financing is still so siloed that it doesn't match up? It's in an integrated fashion you have to apply, Stephen?
Yeah, I think the issue of finance is interesting because, just like has been said,
always comes down to money.
yeah, there's a lot of public and private finances available. Mm-hmm. Okay, but I think the challenge is that a lot of information around that is not available to many.
That's right.
Many people. Okay. We don't know why it is. We don't know who is providing it. You don't open a page where it's all listed.
Right.
These are the finances available. Mm-hmm. And other than that, there's also an issue of capacity to access some of those finances. And there are a lot of, I don't call them restrictions, but some of the requirements.
So what's an example? What's an example of a barrier to accessing a pool of money?
An example to a barrier.
One
of the biggest barriers is the partnerships, because it could be huge money, mm-hmm. which one institution may not be able to gobble up. Yeah, so it's where to look for credible partnerships. I mean, we have experience in terms of partnership building and sustaining. I think it's such a huge challenging area, especially when you have all these heterogeneous actors, coming together. And you're trying to understand each other. I think that has been one of the biggest challenges. Partnership building, sustain the partnerships all along to be able to maybe access some of this financing, use this financing, implement projects, share results. I mean, we have one partnership I want to mention it, but mm-hmm. it's been ourselves and researchers in Africa and Europe. Mm-hmm. And, there has been a huge challenge, first from communicating, because these are researchers communicating research language, and these are farmers trying to mm-hmm. communicate how best they actually do it, to actual project implementation, you're looking at common results, but everyone is taking different trajectories in terms of trying to come up with
the results.
Yeah. So I think it's an issue of accessing that information and then building, the correct partnerships because of, capacities. We have challenges in terms of capacity to access mm-hmm. This particular finance, but I understand finances are there.
Ruth?
Yeah.
If I can add.
Put your microfinance hat on.
Yeah. No, I'm not talking as a farmer.
Yeah.
I'm a serious tree grower.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great.
I started planting trees in 2003 when I was a Minister of State for Defense. I've been in government and I've been hearing carbon money. I own a forest.
Okay.
A square mile of pine.
Nice.
But I've been looking for this carbon money. Mm-hmm. I don't know where it is. And I'm in government. government, and I've been in government for more than 15 years, I am also asking, where is carbon money, this European fund?
Right.
For people who have decided to invest in tree growing, pine grows to maturity for 18 years. Right. You've put your money in something which can, which will yield results after 18 years. Surely you need support.
Yes.
You know? So what Steve has been talking about is something we need to look into to make sure that there are systems of communication, knowing what opportunities they are, so that farmers at whatever level can get access to that. Secondly,
available.
I also wanted to say that when you asked about the obstacle, I wanted to say that sometimes governments don't walk the talk. We say, like in Uganda, agriculture is the backbone of our economy. Agriculture employs 60% of our population. Agriculture is key. Agriculture is, you know.
But we say the same thing here.
When it comes to budgeting, it's a different story, you know. Maybe we have a lot of priority, but we need to devise means of critically and strategically identifying the priorities amongst the enormous priorities. The issue of security is okay. At one time, Uganda was grappling with insurgency in northern Uganda. You could not talk about farming in northern Uganda where people are in IDPs. Okay. Then we had to talk about energy and infrastructure. Because if you talk about value addition, we need electricity. So we need an energy fund so that we can do our dams for hydropower generation. Then the roads. The farmers are always fleeced because of the poor feeder roads. So we need to put money in the roads. Okay? Now, you go on like that. But my mother would like to get access to quality seeds. My mother would like to get an irrigation system that can befit the land tenure system, the highly fragmented land, you know? We need an irrigation system that can fit the land tenure system. My mother will need storage for her produce.
Silos.
My mother will need value addition.
Right.
But you have to tell her that, you know, we are working on insurgency in northern Uganda, and you know, mom, we are now building Karuma Dam because we need electricity. She is not even using electricity. Okay?
So
there are many priorities. We need to really be firm as governments and take on agriculture, because you can get money from agriculture and work on other challenges.
I think what we're hearing about as well is these competing priorities.
Competing priorities,
and,
yes.
You know, Sara, you referred to in the beginning the notion of growing competition over resources. We have to keep in mind that for many of those that most stand to benefit from innovation that's focused on improving the livelihoods of the poor, that these are also the same people who are most at risk in this competition.
Right.
So we've got situations like, for example, addressing the big global challenge of improving agricultural output, improving productivity. Well, a lot of that is also leading to deforestation as the land area expands. 80% of deforestation is led by agricultural expansion. We've got situations where, you know, international investment, again, in increasing agricultural production is displacing farmers. In Madagascar, it was a huge political crisis. So when we think about these platforms to bring different stakeholders together, another of the big barriers is about power.
Right.
It's about who has a voice in decisions. So it's not just enough to say, okay, we've got some farmers, we've got some private sector folks, we've got some government, and we've got some researchers. We really have to learn from the many different experiences, like those that Sara and Anne were referring to, about how to build the kind of processes that create not only effective representation, but also create accountability from those who are making decisions. Mm-hmm. You know, I have, in my personal experience, briefly, having worked in Zambia, where we worked with local communities who were at risk from investment in large-scale commercial aquaculture mm-hmm. that was addressing both water access and land access on the shore. And through this kind of dialogue process, not only were communities able to protect their access and increase their jobs, but government came out of it feeling that, okay, we have a different approach to environmental impact assessment. We can use our existing mechanisms through a dialogue process that actually will help to identify these emerging risks and address them before they become broader conflicts.
Big problem. Yeah.
I think that's a very, very good example of how innovation to the capacity to innovate at different levels mm-hmm. is being nurtured, is being promoted by these kind of platforms. And I think it is very important for research to be actually doing research in the process of these interactions mm-hmm. in order to understand better what is happening, why is it going well, why is it not going well, and doing that in a participatory mode so that the people involved in those platforms are themselves learning as they go along.
Right, and how to bring that to scale, mm-hmm. you know, because the 2 billion yeah. who depend on smallholder agriculture aren't going to necessarily benefit from a set of very localized efforts. Mm-hmm. Right. You know, one of the most impressive examples of this that I've seen is in India, working with a group called Foundation for Ecological Security. Mm-hmm. They've been helping farmers respond to degradation in mm-hmm. terms of the waterways and to rehabilitate areas that were degraded forests and mm-hmm. make them more productive. And this is a 30-year experience that he's evolved now to 5,000 villages in eight states wow. across India. Mm-hmm. And what it shows is that an attention to responding to the needs of the rural poor can lead them to influence at state-level policy and national-level policy as well. But that has taken a long time. What we have to figure out is how to support those kinds of initiatives to go to scale faster. Mm-hmm. And that really, that is the big investment challenge.
Or we have to persuade the investors that they have to wait a little longer for results.
Well, there's patience, but also learning from what has worked well and being able then to go in knowing that we have to deal with the power relationships. We have to create a sense of responsiveness and so forth so that these kinds of platforms can be effective.
I wanted to actually build on that because one of the things that is actually can be disempowering is that this fragmentation of effort from the external actors, private and public actors, mm-hmm. Can actually disempower local groups because the same people are then brought together to be the local farmer organization for water.
Right.
And then there's another local farmers group or community group, because that's not a farmers group, the community group for forestry. But in fact, they're all farmers, and they're also having to split their time, working on value chain stuff. So this issue that the external groups all come in with their separate, there's
agendas.
A road building committee, and the people are being participatory. But part of it is fragmenting the effort that local groups are actually having themselves, splitting the learning opportunities as well. And one of the most interesting things that we've been involved with in the last year through the Landscapes for People, Food, and Nature initiative was in Kenya, where there's a knowledge sharing group that's developed between five different landscape initiatives in Kenya, and they're trying to expand it, and we also had a separate policy project, and they said no. You don't want a separate policy project. Let us be your policy project, okay? So the landscape groups got together, did their own internal assessments of what kind of policies did they need the sort of the new county and the national groups to do that would support their efforts. Mm-hmm. the five groups then got together to discuss what were the commonalities and the lack of commonalities, and then there was a convening together with a bunch of the policymakers in the county and nationally to talk about what kind of actions would be.
So it kind of built.
So they got a voice by aggregating their efforts. Mm-hmm. They actually had a voice that they could go directly to and be operating at a scale large enough mm-hmm. that the policymakers would sort of make the time to talk with them.
Yeah.
So.
There's another point about scaling up. I think that if we're looking to the future 10, 20, 30, 40 years, one way to scale up will have to be through education, mm-hmm. through the education of the people that are coming through for agricultural research and development and the schools, at the universities, at the colleges. And a lot of the lessons that are coming out of this work with innovation platform, innovation systems, that needs to be incorporated into the education in agriculture mm-hmm. and natural resource management and far beyond.
Stephen?
So just something very short. Mm-hmm. You know, we've always felt that a lot of our partners are trying to weaken us as farm organizations.
There's the honest truth.
Yeah, the honest truth. Yeah, and she's actually said it very rightly. You know, there are all these projects and programs organizing farmers into all these farmer groups, you know, mm-hmm. looking at water, looking at this, looking at that, and never a situation where they actually brought together in some, you know, form of aggregation to actually mm-hmm. address, you know, all those issues in a holistic mm-hmm. Kind of way. And it's the same we can even say about government and NGOs mm-hmm. and all that. You've always said mm-hmm. to NGOs, you know, if you're working in Uganda, for example, and you're working with, you know, women group, mm-hmm. yeah, could you make sure that after your activities in Uganda, that you're able to link up with the National Association so they're able to learn, you know, what you're actually doing with that farmer group? They're able to pick that up if it's, you know, a model or
something interesting
mm-hmm. for scaling up and sharing and things like that. So we've always felt that there's a conspiracy to disempower farmers and you know, keep them at that level so they don't, then we are blamed as farmer associations, right. You know, you farm organizations, we don't see you here, we don't hear you, these farmer groups don't talk mm-hmm. about you, are you really representative enough?
Right.
Yeah. So for me, what I'm trying to say is that I think all of us have a collective responsibility. Mm-hmm. And if you really want to see the effects or the impacts of, you know, our programs, our initiatives, our interventions, mm-hmm. there has to be collective responsibility from everybody. Mm-hmm. I think we've said it before mm-hmm. That we're trying to, you know, bring together the farmers so that they can have that economic, mm-hmm. you know, power, so they can be able to also to lobby better. And we cannot do it unless you help us. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't have the resources to actually mobilize everybody. In fact, one of the challenges we have is the fragmentation of farmers. We only represent maybe 25% of the farmers because they're actually part of the associations. Mm-hmm. You know, we have another 70% that is out there that's actually waiting to see what's actually happening with the farmer associations. Mm-hmm. So for me, you're saying, you know, we have to have collective responsibility of all actors, mm-hmm. researchers, government, and everyone. Mm-hmm. If we feel that this is the best institution for the farmers, and you know, it has the ideals and everything, then try and link everybody to this association. It helps, like she said, you know, your transaction costs actually reduce,
right?
Yeah, you know, by just, you know, having an entry point through right. a certain association. We have partners who have actually worked through us in that kind of way. You know, we are here representing Eastern Africa, and there's a partner who wants to work in Southern Africa. I mean, Southern Sudan, for example. Mm-hmm. We say, no, we have an association. Why don't you, you know, access or do your activities through that association? And we feel that not only brings the farmers together, mm-hmm. but, you know, it helps us in terms of you know, not only building our visibility, but, you know, the strength of that collectiveness mm-hmm. among ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Again, the issue of policy comes in, because every NGO that comes to work in a country has to follow the policy, the law mm-hmm. Governing NGOs. Mm-hmm. What we are doing in Uganda is we are revisiting the NGO policy mm-hmm. because we have realized that the problems he has been talking about have been happening. Mm-hmm. When we had insurgents in northern Uganda, every NGO was rushing to northern Uganda,
yes.
and specifically in one town called Igulu, They didn't want to go beyond guru, and there was a lot of duplication.
Yes.
So when issues of accountability comes, because NGOs have to account, then they are duplicating work.
Right.
So we are putting measures to cater for the what he has raised.
Mm-hmm.
So policy guidance is very important.
Yeah, and I think the broader message there as well is that it's not only a matter of investing in programs to help create these sorts of platforms for innovation, but that the policy environment has a big role to play.
Oh, yeah.
And that includes investing in research and partnerships, but it also includes ensuring the space for civil society to be effective, to be able to provide a link, the voice of those who are most marginalized in policy decisions, in decisions about the focus of research, in decisions about the scope for private sector activity as well.
Mm. I wanted to share an experience on... Oh, sorry?
Yeah.
Go ahead. Yeah, I wanted to share an opinion on policy. You know, people think that policy is very easy to influence. That's what people think.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the experience I have is the example I gave of the cooperative law that we're actually trying to push for at the regional level. It's taken us 5 years.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, to actually think through the process, do a lot of analysis, and I can tell you we've formed a lot of partnerships.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, with NGOs, with government, with academia, just for them to understand our thinking and for them to communicate to the, you know, okay, other spaces that, you know, I think what the farmers are doing is actually correct and good,
right.
You know, and please support it. It's not easy.
Right.
And what you're saying is that these NGOs, you know, they talk about them trying to influence policy with a farmer group.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's just impossible.
Okay.
I mean, you can't go to Guru and then influence the national policy in Uganda.
Right.
It's just impossible. I think it tells you that we actually need to have partnerships and work together to be able to influence policy.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we'd love to hear some questions from you all. I've got. He stuck his hand up first.
You basically want examples of how big pots of money at one have actually undermined ongoing activities and have reduced the sustainability at the...
I posit that as a hypothesis. I'm asking whether it's a valid...
I think we could all think of so many different examples of where that has happened, from the very simple thing of when I was living in Nigeria and the people were organizing themselves to build, to maintain a road, and then came the big money which was supposed to maintain this road in a way and means that they couldn't do it themselves, and then that was gone, and then the organization of the people around whom that were organizing this over some period of time had disappeared because somebody had come in from outside. That's just one very small example, but there must be umpteen of these type of things that happen all the time.
Ask it is because we heard this morning in the donor forum that we want to double the budget of the CGIAR. You know, we need much more investment. Well, maybe we do, but there's got to be some kind of corollary to that. And I guess my question to the panel is, what is that corollary?
Sarah,
if I can say, I mean, to me, a lot of the issue it does have to do with who gets to decide how the money is spent. Mm-hmm. I mean, the example that I had was EcoAgriculture working groups, cross-site, cross-landscape things that we were facilitating and supporting in Kenya and Uganda, that really were, the dynamics were really great. among the groups that, mm-hmm. that were working until we decided to go up for a big donor project together, which unfortunately was a donor who had very, very specific ideas about exactly how money should and shouldn't be done. And all this time spent managing the relationships and the long discussions about what was really a priority for the groups as a whole and for their mm-hmm. collaborative work were not considered to be a priority for the donor. So in that case, it was just a real mismatch. And I think in that for the kind of project that was, it needed to be with a donor that had wanted to be rigorous, but that allowed that process of defining the outcomes to be one that was developed locally so that there was total buy-in and then would shape their financing to support that. And I think, mm-hmm. you know, that was just, I think that piece of it is key.
Steve?
Yeah, I think for me, we need more resources. That's definite.
Yeah, we do.
Yeah. I think the challenge that, or the experience that we've actually had is a situation where the predictability of how the money flows in became the problem. Yeah, where you have a time frame to implement a certain project, there's a delay in the funding, and you know money lands and you have 2 months to clear it. I mean that totally disorients you know whatever it is you're actually planning to do. So I think it's an issue of you know, you're clear about your objectives. You've presented this to a donor, but there's a problem in terms of how predictable you know the funds come in, and in the process it distorts. Whatever you've planned to do, and as a result, the achievements. You know, you don't achieve what you actually want to achieve. That, I think, has been the biggest challenge. You know, the predictability of the flow of funds from the donors has been a big challenge.
And how about, I think you, with the beautiful green tie.
Yes.
Thank you very much. My name is Peter Matlin. I'm with the Africa Rice Board. This has been a terrific conversation. I've really appreciated the perspectives as they've been articulated. And I would like to bring us back to the purpose of today, which is to help orient mm-hmm. the CGIAR, chart its path, how it should go forward. We're at a watershed moment where the CGIAR is trying to reinvent itself. One of its commitments is towards new types of partnerships, right, which, if you read between the lines, because it hasn't been written, but if you read between the lines, it's the kind of respectful, bottom-up, egalitarian, adjust your power relationship so that both sides are listening to each other types of partnerships. If you look across the CG centers now, there are some researchers in some centers that would agree with what has been said. The center of gravity among most researchers in most centers is still a top-down modern science domination of the dialogue, where researchers who say they are participating with farmers are actually collaborating the farmers. They are telling the farmers what to do using them in a sense as research assistants.
Yeah.
I'd like to get your perspectives of how does one bring about a change in the CGIAR to be able to live and walk the talk that you've given. I would submit it's not a project, it's mm-hmm. not a program. It's a change in mindset. It's a change in culture. How do you bring that about? Anne suggested education. But look, we don't have enough time to educate, you know, the next generation of researchers in the CGIAR. How do we bring Stephen? About a real change in mindset and culture in the centers to work the way you're suggesting? Because it's really only through that path that we're going to have the kind of impact, sustainable impact, that we're claiming we want to have.
So Stephen gets the first go at this.
Yeah, thank you. In fact, this was supposed to be part of my key message, closing message, but it's good. It's been asked now. If you remember in 2004, during the World Summit on Sustainable Development, one of the things that Kofi Annan said is that the Sustainable Development Agenda will not succeed without including civil society and farm organizations. I mean, he was very clear with that statement. And one of the things that we've actually seen happening after that statement, for example, with IFAD, is that IFAD went ahead and put together what you call the Farmers Forum. that meets every 2 years in Rome or a venue that they actually want to meet. And what the Farmers Forum has actually done is actually it's presented a platform where farmers are able to come and interrogate some of the work that IFAD actually does at the country level, at the regional level, and they're able to present their own strategic or business plans to IFAD to actually consider when it's developing its own, you know, strategies for the next, you know, X number of years. We've seen, you know, some sort of change in IFAD in terms of how it engages from that time on, you know, up to now. We've actually seen it happening. I think for me, it would be important for the CGIAR to be able to look at some of that, you know, approach that IFAD is actually using. You know, where is it possible to actually engage or have a platform where you're able to engage with other stakeholders on a regular basis to be able to interrogate your programs and what you actually do and get, you know, direct feedback from them on a regular basis to inform how then you plan, you know, going forward. Mm-hmm. I know some of the programs have tried to do that. For example, I sit in the advisory committee of the Humatropics program, but that is just in the advisory committee. I think we need to have a platform where, you know, these actors are able to, you know, share in a more truthful way, you know, in terms of how your programs are impacting them. And I think for me, the IFAD example is a perfect case when I think it really works. Mm-hmm. And people really associate. You should see how our members actually associate with the IFAD programs. They actually, you know, are attached to them and linked to them. And they feel that IFAD is actually trying to respond to their challenges.
So, Stephen, the ladies are eager to talk.
Yeah, please.
Can we? And if you can be sort of brief, and I'm going to give each of you a minute to have your final say, and then we're off.
When we are working with farmer innovators, we are looking at positive deviance within the community of farmers. Mm-hmm. I think the CG should, within its own community, look at positive deviance. You have some initiatives within the CG which are positive, which are concerned with things like social learning, which are concerned with things like research in development, which are concerned with trying to enhance the capacity to innovate, to do research in a way which will enhance that capacity. Don't kill it.
Ruth, do you want to, and then we'll finish with...
Thank you very much. I don't know whether time allows me to respond to the
okay, first you want to wait for your...
giving an example where...
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Where money came in and it disorganized the system. This is the National Advisory, Agricultural Advisory Services. It okay. was partly funded by World Bank and then Government of Uganda, where it created a parallel system of extension service delivery. For those who were working for NADS, were highly paid, they were, you know, like pampered, whereas the traditional extension service delivery people were not. So we have now reformed it three times to make sure that we go back to the single spine agricultural extension service delivery.
Okay.
My last...
Can we... is this your summary? I want to get... Sarah wants to say something, and then I'll go... I'll let you do your summaries, okay? Thanks.
Okay. I actually had two very specific practical suggestions, I think. My personal experience as someone who was trained as an economist and went into this whole participatory development stuff having had no training whatsoever about that mindset. It was a real learning experience for me back whatever many decades ago that was. I think you don't learn this without an experiential base. Mm-hmm. And so I think the two key areas that I would make as a recommendation, I think there's a tremendous opportunity to do leadership facilitated dialogue within the CG around these issues that go really deep, that go beyond the love fest kind of thing, but actually address why it is that people are feeling very uncomfortable with these models and what would they have to do. And I think there's people around that can facilitate those kinds of discussions, and I think it's something that needs to happen across the CGIAR. The second element is, there is actually a lot of research going on in about at least six of the CRPs in the CGIAR on integrated land, some aspect of integrated landscape management. But one of the things that's surprising as distinct from sort of maybe your work with Zambia and the Bangladesh mm-hmm. stuff, and like all those centers have some place where they're working where people are really doing it, but there's a real geographic disconnect between those 87 integrated landscape initiatives. They're actually more like 100 that we finally found in Africa. There's no CG research going on in those places with those people who've already set themselves up to do this mm-hmm. and are desperate for research input, desperate for advice. Mm-hmm. But no, people are going to a place where no one's done any integrated landscape management, and they're going to start it all themselves, and they're right. totally not positioned to even do that. So I think there could be some partnership between the groups that are actually doing things on the ground, and they can be learned, you know, they'd be more learning sites, and I think they would welcome CG engagement, and it would be a real reality test to have CG centers with different crops and with different water management, all working in the same places where people are actively trying to move forward on these integrated solutions.
It's sort of
solutions.
The same thing Stephen was saying, that you yeah, want think, that kind of yeah. feedback, the yeah. data that will support whatever you're yeah. and tell you that you're actually doing yeah. a good job, yeah. right?
Sure. Yeah. I'll respond to Peter's comment, and it'll be my closing.
Okay.
my closing bit as well. I think what we need is honesty about processes of change. You know, that when we address barriers to technology adoption, whether it's for drought-resistant seeds or whether it's for improved irrigation or whatnot, when we find that there's barriers in terms of land tenure and women's equity and access to resources, if there are barriers in terms of being able to bring policy makers into the process and so forth, it requires an honesty in saying, let's name those and let's address them. And what we've been talking about, investing in the capacity to innovate, is about investing in institutions mm-hmm. to address the barriers to achieving the headline goals that we all agree about reducing poverty and improving productivity and improving natural resources and improving nutrition. We have to have more honesty about what it really takes to contribute to change that meets those goals.
Sara, you want to sum it up, the most important thought at the end of the day, at the end of this session?
Just one last thought. I think that shifting your overall mental model is the biggest thing that needs mm-hmm. to shift. And I think for the CGIAR and for the entire development organization, it is a different world out there than it was when the CG was established as an institution, where the cultures and norms of the CG were established. And I think the context of climate change, the context of a world that is seriously degrading and a high proportion of the farmers face soil degradation and floods and this kind of thing, where you have extreme changes with urbanization and social processes, it just is no longer true that focus is what the CGIAR needs to do.
Right.
That context, let's find the three or four key things we're going to make a big impact on by doing one thing. Mm-hmm. It is what's not happening in the national systems very, very widely, although it is happening there. What's not happening is a major international effort to understand how agricultural systems are going to change mm-hmm. and providing the research background to understand those processes. And I think it's hugely exciting. It's just a very exciting research mm-hmm. agenda, and it incorporates elements of the existing CG research agenda, and I think they're almost there, but have been unwilling to make that last step, the leap to what it, you know, really embracing that as a cultural change within the organizations.
Anne?
I'm perhaps not quite so positive that they're almost there.
They're moving in the right direction.
I keep thinking when I'm working together with people from certain CG centers, I think, this is what we've been working on all the time, and enhancing the capacity to innovate. And then you go to a CG sort of normal meeting, and you hear the same kind of transfer of technology and transfer of innovation, and just there seems to be a need much more to work on changing that mindset within the CG, that it's not a matter of finding a few silver bullets and transferring them as widely as possible. It's a certain approach to research and development that needs to be expanded as widely as possible mm-hmm. through the CG, but also national centers, sub-national centers in research and development.
Ruth?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was thinking about the importance of empowerment mm-hmm. of stakeholders First of all, true identification of the key stakeholders, mm-hmm. and then empowerment of these mm-hmm. stakeholders. And the key empowerment is through knowledge. So CGIAR mm-hmm. has got knowledge, has interacted with many researchers who would like you to share mm-hmm. with the stakeholders. And that will help us use the meager resources we have, for as long as we are empowered, we have the knowledge, we can achieve the objective.
Okay, I think it's very clear that to really achieve these sustainable development goals, that the farmers and the farm organizations are the center of it. I think for me, what I would only call for is, one, what has been said before, mindset shift in terms of how you engage with this particular constituency. The second thing is that, this constituency is the weakest link as far as other actors in the research fraternity are concerned. So there will be actually need to see how the CG can also invest in terms of building the institutional capacity mm-hmm. of farmers and farm organizations. I think, like you said, we don't want the CG researchers to be collaborating or the farmers to be research assistants in your programs. I think it's best when they have a discussion and have a dialogue like we're having today. And that can only be through trying to empower them and strengthen them. I think I've said that we are trying to promote the cooperative model because it captures many of the spheres that a lot of programs that engage with farmers actually focus on. And we're actually looking for a lot of support for us to be able to have this go through and support in terms of trying to realize the fruits of that institution of farmers. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you all so much for being as honest and frank and open as you have been. It's been really interesting. And now let's all go ponder it.
So. Thank you, Stephanie.
Thank you.